and it will tell us about a new criterion for correctness in the complex Langevin method.
Yes.
With an application to final density.
XQCD. Okay, thank you very much. And first, I would like to thank the organizers for this class. And I'm happy to have the opportunity to give a talk in this nice place. And sorry, today I would like to change the title of my talk. Today's library from the version in the abstract. But today I would like to talk about this topic, the new criterion for the correctness in the complex Langevin method. And I think I'm confident that this result is also useful for those who are interested in the complex Langevin. Now, this work is based on a collaboration with Hideo Matsufuru Jun Nishimura and Shinji Shimasaki at KTK, and this work is based on a recent paper, this one. And in this paper, we have provided some theoretical discussion and application to some simple toy models in one dynamical variable. And in this talk, I would like to talk about its application to gate theories, including QCD and density. Okay, so recently there are many remarkable progress in the study of the complex Langevin method. The formal proof of the correctness was proposed by Arthur and gauge Turing was developed. Then it was applied to QCD, heavy dense QCD, and the QCD at high temperature. So these progresses are really remarkable, I think. But still, there is one crucial question, I think. The complex Langevin or stochastic quantization is free from the probability interpretation of the Boltzmann weight. So at least it is possible to carry out the numerical algorithm, and it is possible to extract some numerical results from the simulation. But the complex Langevin sometimes works well, but sometimes it fails to reproduce the exact result. So there is a crucial question. So how do we distinguish whether the result in the simulation are correct or wrong? That's a very important question. And recently we have revisited the argument for justification of the complex Langevin. Our point is to start from the discretized Langevin equation, and considering these things leads us to a new criterion of correctness in terms of the drift, the probability of the drift terms. I will explain the reason why the drift becomes so important. But anyway, this is what we have found in this paper. And we have applied this criterion to some simple models and also gate theories, and we found that this criterion has three important advantages. One is that this argument is obtained from the criterion is obtained from the theoretical argument, so that this is a reliable criterion, and that's really a signal is very clear. I will show some numerical evidence for this point, and it's very cheap. If you perform the complex Langevin simulation, you must calculate drift terms at every Langevin step. Just use the data of the drift, you can judge the correctness of the simulation. Okay, so the purpose of this talk today is to show how this criterion is useful. And first, here is the outline. First, I will explain some essence of our discussion. Because time is limited, I will skip most part, but I will explain why the drift terms become so important. Then I will apply the criterion to the two-dimensional SU2-Yamit theory. Then I will show some preliminary result for QCD of finite density. Okay, first, let's start from the complex Langevin method with the finite Langevin equation with finite step size. And here we consider a system with dynamical variable z with Langevin time t with finite step size epsilon. And here d is a drift term, which is the derivative of action in terms of variable z. The eta is a Gaussian white noise. And here we define the expectation value of an observable. And here we consider the holomorphic observable. And here, the probability distribution P is defined by this way. And here, the bracket with eta means the average over the noise. Okay, now let's consider the epsilon, finite one-step evolution of these observables. Then, by definition, the expectation value of T plus epsilon is given by this expression, and we can express this probability P of T plus epsilon using the in terms of the probability of P x y at T, and with some algebra we can reduce this expression to this expression second line. So here the L tilde is this operator, and here the colon is kind of the ordering operator to put the derivative in the right hand side. Okay, and in this way, the epsilon evolution of the expectation value is described in this kind of power series. And in order to this power series to converge, at least each term must converge. But here, you see, here we have the drift V, and the drift can be very large. So the nth power of L tilde is proportional to nth power of the drift. Then the probability, in order for this power series to converge, the probability should be suppressed strongly for the large V part, namely the probability distribution should fall off faster than any power law of large drift component. And if the integral converges for any n, then we can take the epsilon goes to zero limit. At this level, we found this expression. And this is just a one-step evolution. And in order to obtain the expectation value, we need to perform the simulation at finite time. Then repeating this epsilon time evolution, then the finite evolution at finite time is expressed in this way. Then again, expanding this expression, we find this expression. And this is very similar to the previous expression, but there is a difference. Here we have the lowering operator here, but in this expression, we don't have the ordering operator. And roughly speaking, the divergence becomes strong. In this equation, the divergence is stronger than the divergence in the previous equation. Anyway, the probability should fall off again the faster than any power of drift terms at large V. So in this way, we found that the probability distribution is pretty important to have the correctness of the complex Langevin. And this is not the end of the discussion. Furthermore, we should show the key relation, namely the connection between the Langevin time average of the observable and its physical average given by the original Langevin integral. And here we show the details in this paper, so please let me skip this part. Okay, so now let me, in this way, the probability of the drift terms is very important for the correctness of the complex Langevin. Now, let me apply this condition to the two-dimensional SU2K theory. Sorry, before that, let me explain the complex Langevin method for K theory with complex action. And just before all the method proposed by XD, first we complexify link variables to SLNC, and we also extend the action and observables as a function of this complexified link variables in a homomorphic manner. Then we apply the Langevin equation for the link variables, which is given by this. And here, here is the drift terms. and this is a Gaussian white noise. In the numerical simulation, we consider only the real noise. We don't include imaginary part. And we use the gauge cooling to stabilize complex Langevin method following this paper. Namely, we perform the gauge cooling gauge transformations after each Langevin step, but here the gauge transformation is not original one, but complex white one, namely the SLMC transformation. Then here we consider the so-called unitarity norm, also defined in this paper. And we define the G and so that this norm is suppressed. Okay, so now we define the probability of the drift terms. First, the drift force in QCD or case theory is defined by this way, and each link has the nc square minus 1 component of the drift force. Then we define the norm of the drift force by this equation. We define the norm for each link. Then we define the probability distribution by this, in this way. So roughly speaking, in numerical simulation, we just calculate the norm of the drift of every random, not every, but every 100 or every 1000 steps, then just count the, just form the histogram from the data. Okay, now let's apply the this criterion to the two-dimensional SQCD theory, which is defined by this equation. And the point is that the analytic calculation is available. We can solve this system using the character expansion technique. And there is originally no sine problem in this case, but extending data to complex, the sine problem appears. And this system with complex data was studied by Makino et al. Using the complex Langevin method last year, and we have just followed their simulation. Okay, here is the numerical data. Here we define the data in this way, and here we change, here the brackets are shown as a function of theta, which is the phase of the complexified lux coupling constant. And the lines are the exact results from the character expansion technique, and the symbols are the numerical results. And the points are the four small phase, the complex Langevin method reproduces the exact result, while for the large phase, it fails to reproduce the exact result. So the question is if we can distinguish these two cases in terms of the probability of the drift terms. Before that, first, let's look at the so-called unitarity norm. Here is the Langevin time history of the unitarity norm for several values of the phase theta. And for all cases, the unitarity norm is under control. So it means the complex Langevin method can fail even if the unitarity norm is under control. This was, again, already found by Makino et al. Last year. So, just looking at the unitarity norm, it's difficult to say this is correct or this is wrong. Okay, now let's look at the probability of the drift terms. Here, the probability is shown as a function of the norm of the drift. And here we employ the log-log plot. Both axes are in logarithmic plot. And, first, please look at the these two cases, these two results correspond to this region. And in this case, the probability falls off faster than exponential. Exponentially or faster than exponential. On the other hand, for this result, which corresponds to this region, the probability distribution has long tail, and it can be, the behavior can be fit with roughly, they can be fit with a linear, and the linear in the log-log plot means the power log. So, as we expected, if the probability distribution as a function of the drift falls off faster than exponential, the complex Langevin is successful, while it has the long tail power log, then the complex Langevin method fails. Okay. So in this way, we can distinguish the correctness, we can judge the correctness of the complex Langevin simulation using the probability of the three terms. Okay, so we have just looked at the simple toy models. Now let's move on to QCD at finite density. Here is a numerical setup. Thanks. And here we consider the finite density QCD at low temperature with light bulbs, to some extent light bulbs. But the lattice simulation, the lattice size is, the spatial extent is 4 and the temporal extent is 8. And we employed off-labeled standard fermion. And the Langevin time is about 10 to 20. And we employed a fixed Langevin step size, epsilon. And we performed the gauge cooling about 10 to 20 times at every Langevin step. And for the fermion part, we use a so-called bilinear noise method with Kogut simpler type improvement, which was introduced in the last conference. And I will show some numerical results, but the results would be preliminary because the Langevin time 20 may not be sufficient to confirm the tail part of the distribution. Okay, so here is the numerical results for the Planck number and Keitaro condensate. And here we perform the two simulations, the complex Langevin and phase quench. And the open circles are phase quench, and this red cross are the complex Langevin. And resulting the complex Langevin agree with those in the phase quench, but a small deviation was found at mu equal 0.5. But this region corresponds to the so-called silver blaze region, so this may be an improvement of the data success of the complex Langevin, but of course it's unclear if these results are reliable or not.
Sorry, phase quench, you mean reweighting from this stage?
Not only the phase quench, just we take the magnitude of the fermion part. Okay, here is the unitarity norm for several values of mu, and the unitarity norm is more or less under control for all the cases. And here is the Dirac eigenvalues, the whole the distribution. And here is the eigenvalues near the origin. And in this case, there is no eigenvalues near the origin, so singularity does not appear. And for these cases, eigenvalues are located near the origin. In this case, we also have some eigenvalues near the origin, but the density is not so high. So just looking at these cases, it's unclear which case is problematic. So just looking at the Dirac eigenvalues or the unitarity norm are not sufficient to judge the correctness of the simulation. So now let's look at the probability of the drift terms. And please look at this figure. And again, the probability is shown as a function of the log u. And the probability fall of the first for small core chemical potential, 0.1 and 0.3. And according to our criterion, these cases, resulting these cases are reliable. On the other hand, for the mu, larger than 0.5, 7, 9, and 1.3, it has a long tail, but it's still, just looking at this figure, it's a bit unclear. The behavior is unclear, but looking at the same figures in the different plot, named the semi-log plot, we can find that for this case, that this tail part is, roughly speaking, that it is fit, it can be fit with a linear. The linear in the semi-log plot means the exponential function. So in this case, the tail part follows the exponential. On the other hand, the 0.79 and 1.3, the tail part seems to be, let's say, the decay of the tail part is slower than the exponential. This way we judge the data mu equal 0.5 is reliable, while the data at large mu would not be reliable. But of course, our simulation is, we perform the simulation up to Langevin time 20, and it may not be sufficient, so now we are still doing some simulations. Okay, so let me conclude my talk. We propose a new criterion of the correctness of the results in the complex Langevin by revisiting the argument for justification. And we have applied this criterion first to the two-dimensional SU2, and this criterion works very well for this case. And today I skip this part, but we have confirmed that this criterion also works well for the chiral random matrix theory, which was taught by Shimasaki in the last conference. And we applied this method, this criterion, to QCD. Okay, and here is the main conclusion. The probability of the drift terms is a reliable criterion of correctness, and it's very cheap. If you perform the simulation, you must have the data of the drift, so please make the probability distribution so it will tell you if the simulation is reliable or not. That's all. Thank you very much.
So Philippe has already a question for Keitaro.
It seems to me that your derivation of this criterion applies equally well to real Langevin.
Real Langevin.
So are you going to predict when real Langevin is going to fail?
No, in that case, in the real Langevin case, we think this does not matter. We have skipped some important part in the derivation, but the important point in the discussion is probability of the evolution of the probability, and the subtlety comes from the large drift path. But in the real Langevin case, if we consider the stable system, the system is stable. We consider that the large drift path is suppressed by the stability of the system. If we consider some, for example, have the negative potential or something like that, then the large drift path can appear. In that case, I think the instability can appear even in the real Langevin. In a real Langevin for the physical stable system, this failure does not occur.
Anders.
So I have a potentially very naive question coming from a computational mathematician, but how did you compute the eigenvalues?
I have used the direct method using some package layback or
some package.
Layback. Because in this case we have used the small lattice size, the volume isn't so large, so such a direct method is available. But if we extend the system to large lattice, then we cannot calculate it. Probably difficult to calculate all the eigenvalues.
So this runs the standard LAPEC QR? Okay.
Time for a last quick question?
Yeah, I'd like to ask about the case mean is 1.3. In that figure, in the naked eye, there is no distribution in the vicinity of zero eigenvalue, but in the next histogram test, you show that there is a polynomial decay for the mu point equal 1.3, so what is the origin for such wrong behavior?
For mu equal 1.3, that decay is exponential.
Is it exponential?
Is it exponential? I think so, using a different plot. Here I didn't show, but using the semi-log plot or some data, it's almost exponential, or faster than exponential.
Okay, I see. Thank you.
Okay, so let's close this session, and there is coffee now. We'll convene again at 4:05.